Ladies and gentlemen, Sean Ray.
It became controversial at the press conference, but I was wrestling with it leading up to the show because, you know, why have the rules if you're not going to enforce them? You know, I was being threatened with a $5,000 fine if or not being allowed to compete if I didn't sign it and send it in. Well, I mean, there was a lot of things going on. You know, 2001 was a year that going in, I didn't feel the same passion. Maybe it was my age. I was 35 years old, training at Mr. Olympia. It was a foregone conclusion in my mind after watching Ronnie Coleman win the 2001 Arnold Classic that he'd more than likely win the Mr. Olympia contest. And it's a very haunting feeling to know you're training for a show that you can't win, which takes us back to all those other Olympias I never won. I believed in every one of them, with the exception of my first in 1988, that I stood a good opportunity to win. And that got me out of bed every day. Getting out of bed in 2001 became a little bit more arduous. It became a job because I felt like I was going to watch the Ronnie Coleman Mr. Olympia in the, you know, show, and it was no longer fun. And a lot of changes were going on. I started longing for things that I didn't have in my life in terms of watching my nieces and nephews grow up. I found myself wanting to take a break while I'm in the preparation for the Olympia, right? Who wants to take a break training for the Olympia? Just, it didn't feel right. And along the way, I was fighting this whole thing with Kevin Levrone, who, he hadn't signed his IFBB Pro card. He hadn't signed his contract for the Olympia. It, technically, he shouldn't have been able to even guest pose at an NPC show because he didn't sign his card in January. It was too much information for me to have as a bodybuilder. I shouldn't have known any of this stuff, but it was brought to my doorstep, and I found myself getting preoccupied with semantics. I competed with Kevin before, beat Kevin before, but he was a formidable challenger, and I thought, you know, if he's not going to follow the rules and I'm following the rules, why is he allowed to compete, type of a thing. And it took my eye off the prize. It didn't make it any more fun that the people around my camp were reminding me that Kevin hadn't signed his contract and he shouldn't be allowed to compete. Make sure Joe Weider knows and bring it up with Wayne D'Amelio. So I got to Vegas with an agenda to make sure that everything was being followed according to the rules of the IFBB. And with Wayne D'Amelio at the helm, Wayne D'Amelio actually assured me that the rules would be followed. He actually seemed to relish in the idea of enforcing the rules. And on the 11th hour, he pulled me aside and said, "Hey, it's Joe Weider's call. Kevin's a Joe Weider sponsored athlete. If Joe wants Kevin in the show, Kevin's going to be in the show." And then that was it. That was it. So Kevin's in the show. So at the end of the day, then Kevin wound up getting third, and I wound up getting fourth. And then I find out that Jay Cutler failed the diuretic test that year, and it should have been thrown out, which if that were held, you know, to the letter of the law, I would have been out, I would have been third, and then Jay Cutler would have been disqualified and I would have wound up in second. So armed with all of that information in the aftermath of the 2001 Mr. Olympia, I felt like I was a little too smart for this sport, you know. I wasn't there to just take any answer that was given to me. I'd see, you have the rules or you don't. I mean, I failed a drug test. I had money taken away from me. I battled back and I passed the test and I came back the following year and I won the contest. So I just kind of felt like the rules were being bent and shaped to fit situation in 2001. And seeing what Ronnie looked like in 2001 and watching Jay, you know, come from ninth place to second place, have the drug test thrown out even though he'd failed, and Kevin allowed to compete even though he wasn't even registered, I felt this was probably a good time for me to turn the page. And no, I never lost. I'm still a fan. I'm not emotionally invested, so I don't fight the fights that are there. But mind you, I did come back after taking that 1 year off in 2002. It gave me a chance to meet my fiance, and then in 2003, she became my wife. We've been married 13 years now. Two kids. So that sabbatical helped shape the rest of my life. You know, I mean, if I didn't take that time off, I probably would have never met my wife. I probably would have never had kids. The timing was right. But I re-engaged in 2003 to become an athlete's representative and represent the athletes. And what I found was I was more emotionally invested in having things change for the better for the athletes than the athletes that were actually competing were. And when I realized that they didn't have the same passion that I had as a competitor, I'm fighting an uphill battle. If I don't have the support of you guys trying to make change, who am I making change for? And 6 months into that position, I walked away from it because I was, some of the things I was trying to get changed were radical for the time. I wanted every athlete to have prize money that showed up at the Mr. Olympia. I wanted different judges every single year at the Mr. Olympia on principle alone. I wanted the scores available on the night of the show for transparency. I want to see the individual scores of each judge. I wanted partitions in between the judges so that the judges couldn't sit at the same table and look down at what each judge is doing. I wanted some separation so we had some independent thinking. And I couldn't get the support of the athletes to stand up and stick their neck out. You know, the one that sticks the neck out is the one that gets his head chopped off. So I became this rebel with a cause, and really my cause was to make things better. I quit, ironically. Every athlete that following Mr. Olympia got $4,000 when they showed up at the Mr. Olympia. The following year, it dropped to $2,000 for participation. And then the following year, that disappeared. It went back to paying only the top 10. Wayne D'Amelia, he got the boot because he was trying to do some shady stuff behind Joe Weider's back. Joe Weider then partnered up with AMI. The infrastructure of the Weider Enterprise had changed, and I moved on and worked with Robert Kennedy at Muscle Mag International for 2 years. And then I wound up with Steve Blechman in 2007, and I've been with him ever since. So I don't have any fights to fight. I work in the news media, and I report the news as I see it. It sucks because when it's all said and done, you have this dream of what could have been. It's only one person. When I said Dorian Yates is bloated and he had a torn bicep, it's because it was true. You can't reward that. Dorian wouldn't give back one of his standout trophies, I guarantee you.